Okay, good morning and welcome back. Today is July, Wednesday, the 14th of July, and this is Class 20, Reading Chuangzi. We're doing a quick review, I think, of Chapter 8 called Webbed Toes. And this is considered the first of the non-inner chapters or the outer chapters of the complete Chuangzi text of 33 chapters. And that's because scholars have come to believe, or there's some agreement, that it was of a different source or later origination, a little bit different than the previous seven chapters. And I think that's absolutely true. It's very clear to me when I was reading it over in the last few days that this is not the same voice or speaker as the first six, seven chapters. This guy is probably an ex-Confucian, or a student of Zhuangzi, or another Taoist of the time. And there may be multiple sources in each of these chapters as well. It's a tighter style of teaching, more formal, can seem a little judgmental. It also cl clearly, to me, uses the previous style of historical examples, saying that these people were examples of, the non-Taoist way, which in this case, this chapter is very much against what he called what was translated here as being over nice in the ways of benevolence and righteousness. So the errors of benevolence and righteousness for the common reformer, Confucian seeker, it's very much against ossified, rigidified notions and performance of virtue as being not in harmony with Tao and Tao De, the way and its virtue. I want to also just say before I jump in, and I think today it's going to be a little shorter, if possible, doing brief final commentary on chapter 8 and then moving into 9 or doing a quick read through of 9. The previously Weebly alternate mirror site is complete and now has its own non-Weebly domain name, which is nice because that I can't quite enjoy the name Weebly. It just sounds like some kind of infirmity. But the new site is www.twsmandalkar.com. So twsmandalkar.com. The new site, mirror to YouTube, all 900 plus videos or talks available, download and streaming, everything's free. And very straightforward site, no descriptions, no text other than bio and counseling information and some resources, lots of links. But all 27 playlists, all well organized. If anybody finds an error or a problem there, please let me know because it was just completed and my friend in Australia did a yeoman's work uploading and designing on Weebly, and now we have our own domain. So www.twsmandalkar.com. And I think it looks good. It's nice, simple, simple, and that's just the way I like it. So everything's there, presumably, all 27 playlists, and it's useful to bookmark if you'd like an alternate source. And it's all MP3, so it's comparable to the podcast site, and download and streaming are both working. But if there's any problem, let me know. So now, Chapter 8, Webbed Toes. Clearly, to me, not the same speaker as the previous chapters, who really was very free and playful, freer than the one who put together Chapter 8, for sure. And the focus here is what is the right approach to Tao and Tao De? And so, this is starting on page 149 of the Burton Watson translation PDF. And he's talking about this is not the right approach to the way and its virtue, right? Tao and Tao De, the Tao Te Ching. And so what is the right way? Well, we've gone through that a lot. Most of this chapter is talking about not the right way. The right way is associated with not adding to what doesn't, not adding on. This is in many ways, web toes is used in two ways, saying adding the web to toes is unneeded, don't do it. That's the wrong way to Tao and Tao De, or to authenticity, because this is very much about authenticity and the performance, the life of Wu Wei, meaning non-interference, non-interruption, and non-addition, not adding in, not being over nice. And so there's a virtue that's non-dual, and there's a virtue that's dual. There's morality and positive path, or a useful approach that it sounds like that can be interpreted in rightly and wrongly. And so web toes here refers to two different ways of approaching life and self and virtue and good works, self-development and virtue and good works and what's needed on the path. One is that adding what's not needed, the practice of benevolence and righteousness that is so-called over nice in the use of hearing and sight, or web-toed in eyesight. Over nice really means exaggeratedly virtuous. Now, for us, we may not be parading around reforming society intending to that. I'm not. We're not approaching rulers trying to teach them the right way. We may be trying to help people around us, and then we're also trying to help ourselves. So this term over nice, which is very unclear, actually, what does it mean? It's exaggeration. It's inauthenticity. It's incongruity, meaning I'm not my process or my, you know, expression to other in service and my way of working with my own mind is somehow inauthentic. So that we're talking about authenticity and inauthenticity. Authenticity is the right way, quote, is just one way of talking about the right approach to Tao and Tao De. And Wu Wei is the basis of that, quote, right way. And that is the opposite. The opposite of that is over nice or perverse, becoming deluded and perverse in the practice of benevolence and righteousness. And so the practice of righteousness and benevolence is applied in our service or helpful or service to other perspective in relation to others, and also how we work with our own mind. And one can be authentic or self-deceiving. One can be very straightforward and very present without any manipulation in how we speak or how we are with ourselves. Or one can be somehow a bit dishonest. So honesty in working with ourself really means, obviously, don't fool yourself. Don't, you know, like the woman in the chapter Shattering Armor in Universal Vision, who said, I was in the middle of some very strong emotional catharsis and said, I thought I finished all this shit years ago. Well, that's the result of self-deception. We all do it somewhat. Thinking that because something is not present, it's gone. Well, there is a subconscious and the invisible, and there's deep wounding that doesn't get healed in one shot. And likewise, in relation to others, we may be fooling ourselves, thinking that they're open to us when they're not, or they're more open than they are, or we're helping when we're not, or there really is an opportunity to be of service when there isn't much. I mean, people who are telling us their troubles and their pain may not necessarily want to hear what we have to say. And one shouldn't pretend they do when they don't. one should see things clearly. And that is a kind of authenticity, or not adding what's not there, not becoming web-toed in eyesight or hearing, not being fork-fingered with benevolence. And here, of course, it's very macro, saying he who's fork-fingered with benevolence, meaning adding an extra finger or something, adding on what doesn't need add-on, will tear out the virtue given him and stifle his inborn nature in order to seize fame and reputation, leading the world on with pipe and drum in the service of an unattainable ideal. This is not applicable to us in general, because most of us are not trying to lead the parade on the world stage. But it does happen in the microcosm in interaction with others. And it does happen in the microcosm when we're alone thinking about our process. And the goal is to be in harmony with inborn nature, xing. And that's completely the way of the Zhenren. So the Zhenren is in harmony with Tao De, but that means in harmony with inborn nature, which means true nature, which certainly is about just a butterfly floating down from the top of the window to the bottom, a white butterfly, without flapping his wings, just basically coasting straight down. Very strange. So he's trusting the air to support him, or to make sure that his descent is safe while effortless. All he's doing is knowing that the environment is safe, and without flapping wings whatsoever, letting the safety, his recognized safety of the airflow, the air pressure, let him descend gracefully, gently, from above the window to the below. This is a kind of wu wei, perhaps. The point is not to be inauthentic, and not to get into trouble with others, and not to fool ourselves, I think. So bottom page 150, he who holds to true rightness doesn't lose the original form of his inborn nature. And this is the other read of webbed toes, where if indeed that condition that seems deleterious or an aberration, if indeed that's what is, it's acknowledged and appreciated as is. So the text says, so for him, joined things are not webbed toes, meaning what's put together that seems superfluous is not considered a problem. Things forking off, like the extra finger, are not superfluous fingers. The long is never too much, the short is never too little. So when it's long, it's long. When it's short, it's short. Now, in the world today, it's very, tyranny is tyranny. And restriction of freedom is restriction of freedom. It's not, I'm not recommending acceptance of tyranny. But there is a sense of don't fool yourself, and don't fight what can't be changed. If it can't be changed, we need to accept it and deal with it in another way other than changing it, if indeed it can't be changed. So he said, what is long by nature needs no cutting off. What's short by nature needs no stretching. That and so he said, I wonder then if benevolence and righteousness are part of man's true form. It's kind of repeating the same theme that our conceptions of virtue and goodness may not really be authentic. They certainly may not be fitting with anyone we're talking to. And so if that other person is really not open, we should know it. If the person can go only a little way in listening or talking, we should know it. If the person is in pain but they don't want to hear our view, we should know it. We should know what is and accept what is, and then figure out what we wish to do with it. But idiot compassion is unrecommended. That's Trungpa Rinpoche's term, idiot compassion. the compassion without wisdom. And so this is benevolence and righteousness with wisdom. The wisdom here is what is the situation we're facing, and can we be honest and unmanipulative, non-real, genuine enough to accept what it is. And so for the woman in the story, you didn't fully heal this pain. And we all have pain and sorrow from the past that we haven't healed, nearly everyone. And we can heal it, or it can be healed, but just because it doesn't appear today doesn't mean it's finished. And so these vasanas and traits that may not even be present may be catching us because at some level we're not being honest. Honest with ourselves, and then honest in our assessment of a dialogue or a relationship with another person. And that's a sort of finding relevance to this ancient teaching that's very much against the lack of authenticity in the Confucian notions of benevolence and righteousness at the time. And top of 152, in terms of a Taoist ideal, for in the world there can be constant naturalness. Where there is constant naturalness, and I would say authenticity, things are arced not by the use of the curve, straightened not by the use of the plumb line, rounded not by compasses, squared not by T-squares, joined not by glue and lacquer, bound not by ropes and lines. Those things are not needed. They're either joined or arced or not. He says, then all things in the world, simple and compliant, live and never know how they happen to live. All things, rude and unwitting, get what they need and never know how they happen to get it. Actually, this is very much copying Tao Te Ching. And that's why it's very clear that this is not the author, to me, of the first six or seven chapters. And it's really quite clear that this person is not of the same stature as Chuangzi or the inner chapters to me. And it's just saying many of the same things in different ways that doesn't actually add to what we've seen before, in my view. Let's just read from the final sections of the final paragraph, 154. What is his ideal? That I'm saying is authenticity and honesty with in accord with what is, whether it's our own process or the condition of others that we're trying to help or trying to have good relationship with. He said, my definition of expertness, expert with regard to your virtue, even that is kind of problematic. You know, you're not expert in virtue. You're either surrendered all the blockages to inborn nature or not. And so there is some problem with this chapter, in my humble opinion. But he said, my definition of expertness has nothing to do with benevolence or righteousness in those formal, somewhat artificial ways. It means following the true form of your inborn nature, that is all. When I speak of good hearing, I don't mean listening to others, I mean simply listening to yourself. Which is a useful way to listen to others. When I speak of good eyesight, I don't mean looking at others, I mean simply looking at yourself. And so it's a matter of being honest with ourselves, being committed to honesty and truth with ourselves. Then naturally we will hear others well and see others well and see our own process well. And that's buddhi, just as Nityananda said, you know, buddhi as a means of a function of mind so we can know our strengths and weaknesses or know the nature of the mental process. And so know yourself and accept, you know, Ross said, know yourself, accept yourself, become the creator. Know yourself, accept yourself means be committed to honesty. If you're feeling bad, feel bad. If you're feeling hope, you know, feel it. But understand the difference between expectation and hope. Be realistic, you know, expect reality and don't fool yourself in any way. And he said, he who does not look at himself but looks at others, meaning look but only looks at others, who doesn't get a hold of himself but only gets a hold of others, is getting what other men have got and failing to get what he himself has got. He finds joy in what brings joy to other men, but finds no joy in what would bring joy to himself. And so start with the self. Start with what I is, or seeking to be in harmony with true nature. And understand the principles of Wu Wei, or harmony with true nature, inborn nature. It's not as complicated as it may seem. It's really just green, blue, indigo. And so the more people understand the qualities of mind associated with fourth and fifth and sixth chakras, green, blue, indigo, one will know Wu Wei and know what it means to know yourself, accept yourself. And by that, then naturally one becomes the creator, or one increases one's knowing that I is all. Not the personal I, the universal I, or true nature, is all. That's, you know, ultimately beyond our current incarnational experience. If we can have moments of experience of unity, or you know, infinity of consciousness, infinity of space, like in the higher trances in Buddhism. But in general, we're going to default to this experience of embodied, separative identity. Separative me, my personality, my process, in this body right here, with a very limited length of this lifespan. And that's not all is all, and I is totality, and I am the one, all is the one infinite creator. Those are true. It's true. But it's not really practically experienceable as a default mode, except for people who have done massive practice and surrender and transformation and are working from sixth chakra, not seeking to do green, blue, indigo, but have finished green, blue and are very much working from a highly spiritualized, embodied and conscious self-conscious experience in the way of non-duality. That's just not, you know, common for most. So don't forget yourself. And final point here, he writes, I have a sense of shame before the Tao and Tao De virtue, or the spiritual universal power. And for that reason, I don't venture to raise myself up in deeds of benevolence and righteousness, or to lower myself in deluded and perverse practices. So avoiding self-aggrandizement or glorification or self-amplification, and avoiding the harmful ways of thinking and living in the world. That's obviously critical. So, chapter 8, really short, actually, called Horses' Hooves. Yeah, let me see what the time is. All right. So, chapter 9, Dongzi, called Horses' Hooves. And you'll see certain stylistic elements similar to chapter 8. But each one of these chapters is sort of its own composite of perhaps multiple authors and additions and changes over time. So let's read through. Changzi, chapter 9, Burton Watson translation, called Horse's Hooves. He said, horses' hooves are made for treading frost and snow, their coats for keeping out wind and cold, to munch grass, drink from the stream, lift up their feet and gallop. This is the true nature of horses. Though they might possess great terraces and fine halls, they would have no use for them, meaning horses may have the trappings of wealthy and famous folks, great terraces and fine halls. They have no use for them, meaning their true nature is different than ours. He goes on, then along comes Bo Lu, Bolu, who says, and this is an example that he'll teach from, "I'm good at handling horses," he announces, and proceeds to singe them, shave them, pair them, brand them, bind them with martingale and crupper, meaning prepare them for domestication, tie them up in stall and stable. By this time, 2 or 3 out of the 10 horses have died. He goes on then to starve them, make them go thirsty, race them, prance them, pull them into line, and force them to run side by side, in front of them the worry of bit and rein, behind them the terror of whip and crop. By this time, more than half the horses have died. Don't do this to your true nature. The potter says, "I'm good at handling clay. To round it, I apply the compass. To square it, I apply the T-square." The carpenter says, "I'm good at handling wood. To arc it, I apply the curve. To make it straight, I apply the plumb line." But as far as inborn nature is concerned, the clay and the wood surely have no wish to be subjected to compass and square, curve and plumb line. Yet generation after generation sings out in praise, saying, "Bolu is good at handling horses. The potter and the carpenter are good at handling clay and wood." And the same fault is committed by the men who handle the affairs of the world. This is very, very appropriate for today. Humans praising humans, completely oblivious to their true nature. "In my opinion," he goes on, "someone who was really good at handling the affairs of the world would not go about it like this. The people have their constant inborn nature to weave for their clothing, to till for their food. This is the de that they share, the virtue, Tao de, that they share. They are one in it and not partisan, and it is called the emancipation of heaven." Right? Handling the affairs of the world in accord with their constant inborn nature. "Therefore, in a time of perfect de, perfect virtue, the gait of men is slow and ambling. Their gaze is steady and mild. In such an age, mountains have no paths or trails, lakes no boats or bridges. The 10,000 things live species by species, one group settled close to another." See, this chapter is not written by the same guy who wrote the last one, or the same team. "Birds and beasts from their flocks and herds greet or form their flocks and herds. Grass and trees grow to the fullest height. So it happens that you can tie a cord. So it happens that you can tie a cord to the birds and beasts and lead them about, or bend down the limb and peer into the nest of the crow and the magpie," meaning the birds and the beasts have no fear of humanity because they've not been domesticated or manipulated. "In this age of perfect virtue, men live the same as birds and beasts, group themselves side by side with the 10,000 things. Who then knows anything about gentleman or petty man, Confucian terms, dull and unwitting? Men have no wisdom." This is meaning no sophistic artifice as wisdom. "Dull and unwitting, men have no, quote, wisdom. Thus their duh, their virtue, does not depart from them. Dull and unwitting, they have no desire. This is called uncarved simplicity. In uncarved simplicity, authenticity, the people attain their true nature." Then along comes the sage, quote, "sage, huffing and puffing after benevolence, reaching on tiptoe for righteousness. And the world for the first time has doubts, mooning and mouthing over his music, snipping and stitching away at his rites, and the world for the first time is divided. Thus, if the plain unwrought substance had not been blighted, how would there be any sacrificial goblets? If the white jade had not been shattered, how would there be any scepters and batons?" It's meaning, the human fashionings damage original nature or nature as is. If the way and its virtue If thou and the had not been cast aside, how would there be any call for benevolence and righteousness? If the true form of the inborn nature, Xing, had not been abandoned, how would there be any use for rites and music? If the five colors had not confused men, who would fashion patterns and hues? If the five notes had not confused them, who would try to tune things by the six tones? That the unwrought substance was blighted in order to fashion implements, this was the crime of the artisan. That the way and its virtue, Tao and De, were destroyed. You can't really destroy it, but obstructed. In order to create so-called benevolence and righteousness, this was the fault of the sage. Quote, sage. When horses live on the plain, they eat grass and drink from the streams. Pleased, they twine their necks together and rub. Angry, they turn back to back and kick. This is all horses know how to do. But if you pile poles and yokes on them and line them up in crossbars and shafts, then they will learn to snap the crossbars, break the yoke, rip the carriage top, champ the bit, and chew the reins. Thus horses learn how to commit the worst kinds of mischief. This is the crime of Bolu. In the days of He Shu, people stayed home, but didn't know what they were doing. Walked around, but didn't know where they were going. Their mouths crammed with food, they were merry. Drumming on their bellies, they passed the time. This was as much as they were able to do. Then the sage came along with the crouchings and bendings of rites and music, which were intended to reform the bodies of the world. With the reaching for a dangled prize, of benevolence and righteousness, which was intended to comfort the hearts of the world. Then, for the first time, people learned to stand on tiptoe and covet knowledge, to fight to the death over profit, and there was no stopping them. This, in the end, was the fault of the sage. And so this is a harsh criticism to the ignorant, interfering reformer, the sage or the reformer, or the world server or the helper, or, you know, the road to hell paved with good intentions. The misguided server, the inauthentic helper, the social activist who actually hates herself, the psychologist who's actually afraid to look into spiritual topics because they don't want to be seen as a crack or a crank or a quack. The person who doesn't appreciate natural order and believes there's a problem when there isn't. Now, there are problems, or are there? Ross saying, you know, all is perfect, complete and whole and perfect from the view of higher self. Well, it's very hard to look at the world today and say it's complete and whole and perfect, or the world, meaning humanity, and say it's complete and whole and perfect. It's impossible for me to do that. Probably that's a mark of my lack of development. However, Gautama, you know, harshly criticized a monk who broke certain rules and encouraged others to do so. Nityananda threw stones at some troublemakers and even assisted the early death of a black magician, Mantra Yani, at a wedding ceremony in southern India. Now, is that example of making trouble and adding web toes where it's unneeded? Let the Mantra Yani continue to enslave people in the village by his occult power, or let the troublemaker come into the Sangha and bring people away from following teachings or inspire doubt where there didn't need to be? Should that all be allowed? Well, I don't think so. I'm not saying you should do anything. What we should do is understand deeply. So indeed, there are many situations where helping is hurting, or the way we're helping is not helping, or things are the way they are, but we don't really see them because we don't really want to fully see them. We don't acknowledge what is, partly because we feel too much pain. Fine. At least we should know that. People who don't want to face, when we don't want to face certain truths, and other people around us who are willing to face even less. And then the difference between they and us, we're not the same. You know, green, yellow is not indigo. It is not. Meanwhile, all is one. And it's all Maya or illusion, or it's impermanent. And actually, it's not unreal. It's simply impermanent. It's not fake. What is. However, it's more than it appears. So things are not as they appear, nor are they otherwise. They are not otherwise than how they appear, and they're more than as they appear. They're not fully only as they appear, nor are they exclusive. Well, are they excluding how they appear? So appearance has apparent reality, and true nature has essential, undying reality. And we shouldn't be making trouble. And so here, this is a very, very classic kind of Taoist perspective that before there was rites and ritual and righteousness and benevolence and the ways of virtue, there was a natural virtue. There was a natural way. I wouldn't idealize it as he seems to be, but I mean, really, we're talking about the development of greater mental activity and function in evolving humanity through the 3D cycle. So as the cycle goes from Lemuria through Atlantis to the final portion, the three major cycles of the master, 75,000 year master cycle, humanity does a run through of chakras 1 through 7. So at the end times today, 3.7, in terms of time sequence or stages of time through the 75,000 years, clearly we're at the end. How long it'll last, I don't know. 200, 500, 700 years is nothing compared to 75,000. And so here at the phase of 3.7, humanity is as complex and mentally developed and mental as kind of crazy as it could be. And that's not wrong. It's simply planetary evolution, soul evolution through a 3D cycle. The problem is that there's so much dishonesty. So much dishonesty. And the fear of honesty, it seems to me. So we shouldn't fall into that. When you're unhappy, be unhappy. When you're angry, be angry. At least feel it. You know? So right action, right speech means right restraint. Right action, right speech demands right restraint. But that's not dishonesty because I feel it and choose not to speak it. I have such thoughts and desires and I choose not to act upon them to not hurt you and not hurt me. Okay, that's totally honest and fair. But don't fool yourself and don't fake yourself. And when something happens that you didn't expect, acknowledge I didn't see. I could have, some people did, but I didn't. Okay, doesn't mean you're a loser. It means something, we have our blind spots. So we all have our blind spots. And we all have our attachments. And we all have our selfishness. Meanwhile, the more we know that and meet it with love and understanding and acceptance, the less of it we'll have. And the more we'll be living in green, blue, indigo. And so this is a teaching against misguided service to other, misguided social reform. And terms like simplicity, uncarved block, inborn nature, wu wei, are all guidance in accord with a deep commitment to honesty and loving truth. The truth of my present process, the truth of the world process, the truth of the other person, which is not the same as what I see now. It's what I see now. Knowing there's more than I see with the other person or the world, and there is a historical precedent or there's a historical basis. You know, I look at 10 pictures of a person, they look different in every single one. It's weird, I think, frankly. Why? Because the light and their mood and conditions. And so, who is he or she? All of that. Then, all of that to what degree? Well, then we get to advanced discernment. A person's character is not simple. There is a default, and then there is all the potentials and the outliers. So some people could be profoundly wise and understanding, in other ways extremely stuck or dogmatic or completely ignorant. And us too. And that's very strange, I think. It's the instability of living in this dimension. So in any case, I don't think this is the fault of the sage. It's the fault of the fact that there's so many negative souls allowed by the Logos to live in this world. And that's not a fault, that's a plan. It's divine plan and divine design that this world has. The percentage of negatively oriented souls at base of beingness that it has. What is that? Well, I recently have been thinking it could be 20, 30%. Could be a quarter, it could be a third. I don't know if it's that much. But we could have a 55, 30, 15 situation here. 55% of humanity is positive at base of beingness. 30% is negatively oriented. Straight up, you know, straight out of Compton. Not Compton, actually straight out of Mars and Maldek. And rightly under the thumb of Orion. And 15% are real young souls who are just moving into some kind of self-consciousness, meaning not much evolved in their density, 3.22, that kind of thing. So, in any case, that's not my fault. That's the Logoic plan. And if that's the case, we should acknowledge, yeah, that's why humanity is the way it is at the end of the 3D cycle. And this was, you know, John of Patmos' Book of Revelation, talking about Apocalypse and Armageddon. This was known thousands of years ago that it would be a messy end to the 3D cycle. And it could not have been otherwise, it seems to me. And that's probably because there's a higher percentage of negatives here than we might think. Who thinks this way? Not many people think too deeply about anything, actually. And if that's the case, if you agree, then how to be with others who don't want to think deeply about anything much at all? And that's definitely happening. This is a dumbing down, intensified dumbing down, and trauma-based mind control phase of history. Definitely. And it's very ugly, actually. And what the hell does this Taoism have to do with it? Well, some ways yes, some ways no, some things yes, some things no, but it has to be modified. Ultimately, the uncarved block, or Wu Wei here, I'd say, counsels the fearlessness to accept it fully as it is first, to see it fully, clearly, regardless of how we feel about that, which will be probably some dismay and the sense that it's so bitter. I feel bitter. I'm galled by what I see here. Like that. Okay. You know, okay. God is still here and the sky is still beautiful, actually, behind the fakery. And, you know, like Nityananda said, Saturn is there, but God is here too. Yeah, right. And this too shall pass and we'll just be here for a while. And it ain't my planet. It ain't my planet. It ain't my group. This ain't my home. Babylon will never be my home, as they say. So, that's how I look at it, and I think that's authentic and unvarnished and non-interfering or non-self-deceiving. I think that's critical. So, all right. With that said, let me take a look at how long is Chapter 10. Chapter 10 is a bit of work, 170. I think we're just going to leave it at that. It's enough. And so, ho-ho, a short talk today, under an hour. Next time we'll pick up at Chapter 10, Rifling Trunks. Rifling Trunks. Again, these chapters are not inner, they're outer, and they are composited and later. And if you recognize that, and wish at some point, at least it's, I think I'll do this personally on my own, is go back to the inner chapters, 1 through 6 or 7, and appreciate the voice and the perspective, because that comes from somebody who's from an earlier time and freer than the later team or teams of writers who compiled chapters 8 through 33, it seems to me. And other than that, that'll be it for today. The key here is authenticity, and that means that I value clear seeing, knowing, truth, honesty, above my valuing of good feeling. I value good feeling, but I value knowing even higher. And that means, again, knowing in association with humanity and the collective, knowing and seeing in relation to people around us, friends and families, and anyone with whom we're in relationship or communication. Knowing, seeing authenticity in relation to subconscious or ourself, what I is, psychologically, personally, and spiritually as well. Don't forget what you are, but don't avoid the bitter, dark portions of who you are. Right? Who I am is a personal mind-body entity. And what I am is the source of this mind-body-spirit complex experience as a whole. And one should be real. Honest is really the right way. Really, honesty. Honestly, intrinsically includes love and green ray. So a commitment to true, unblocked Blu-ray will naturally energize, activate, include green ray, all the qualities of green ray. So that's important to know. So again, next time we'll start chapter 10. So shorter than before. I hope this was useful. Thanks for being here. Take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.